Hello, folks. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is your Paul Revere Show. We are here every Monday night at 7 o'clock at WAUK 540 AM 101 FM. And you know, folks, we're here. We're trying to talk about what's the latest in Wisconsin, what's happening, how do we keep it moving forward. There has been a lot of discussion about the budget process, shared revenue, many key important issues. And tonight I am honored and privileged to have with us Alderwoman JoCasta Zamarripa from Milwaukee. 8th District, is that right, JoCasta?
That's correct, Attorney Thomsen. Absolutely correct. The 8th Alderman District.
So welcome. And I'm really privileged to have you on the show. You know, you've been a public figure in Wisconsin for quite a while. And I don't know if my listeners have necessarily had a chance to meet you or listen to you. So just before we get into some of these hot issues that's facing every community, how about a little bit about your background? You know, how'd you get into politics? I know you were a state rep for a while, but give us an update.
Yes, and thank you so much, Mark Thomsen, and the Paul Revere Show for having me on. Mark, you've known me since I was just a whippersnapper, trying to get into politics. Also, many years ago, I was first elected in 2010 to the Wisconsin State Legislature as a state representative to the assembly, the successor of our dear friend, Judge Pedro Colon. He was the first Latino ever elected to the Wisconsin State Legislature, and I'm so honored to call myself his successor. When I got elected, I became the first Latino woman elected to the state legislature, serving in our assembly for just about a decade before I left in 2020 to become an alderwoman in the city of Milwaukee, and I'm honored to still be a voice for Milwaukee's Near South Side in that local governmental body.
So, you know, this is not your first run-in with budget and shared revenue and what that means to local governments. And before we really get into some of, you know, your perspective specifically in terms of Milwaukee and this deal, you know, what is the experience and knowledge base that you bring to the conversation based on your 10 years in Madison and seeing how the whole budget process goes and the whole concept of shared revenue? What is sort of that big global picture? What are we looking at?
Well, we're looking at historically, and you said it, Mark, I was just watching your episode from last week. You know, we're coming off of 20 plus years of Milwaukee really being starved of our fair share of shared revenue by the state. And so it's been very difficult being a state representative in the assembly. You know, my party, I'm a Democrat. My party was in the minority my entire tenure in the legislature. And it's very hard to get good things passed in a Republican dominated legislature. You know, they have a majority in both houses, and they did so when I was in office for the overwhelming almost 10 years, they had an entire majority in the executive branch, the assembly, the Senate. So you can imagine how nightmarish it was. My last term in the legislature, I was so honored to serve with a Democratic governor in the executive branch, Tony Evers. And that was a great honor for me because I didn't know that. I came in when Walker came in, and it was a nightmare for almost a decade there. So I know how difficult it is to get good things for the people of Milwaukee passed in a Republican-controlled state. And so this is a generational opportunity that is before us, and it's so imperfect, I know. And yet we still have some big votes to take here.
So, you know, just over your tenure, you know, and particularly, you know, we got like almost a $7 billion surplus now. So many communities, and it's not just Milwaukee that has suffered because of shared revenue. How did you see communities around the state? Because I know you've traveled around the state as well. How are they responding to being starved too?
I mean, absolutely, you're right. And it's important for us to note when we talk about this state shared revenue bill, this is not just Milwaukee, as you just said. This is all 72 counties in the great state of Wisconsin. The towns, the villages, the cities finally will be seeing an increase in their shared revenue. So it wasn't just us, although we were. I mean, Milwaukee, unfortunately, Republicans, generally speaking, kind of looked onto Milwaukee with some disdain, as you know. But the truth is that their local governments across the state have been suffering and not seen an increase in their shared revenue. So this bill, that's why so many folks will speak to it as being generational, to finally get an increase across the board for local governments across the state of Wisconsin. This is big. We need it. The governor knows we need it, and he's in a tough spot right now as he is trying to fight for Milwaukee, but not just Milwaukee, for all 72 counties in his great state, in our great state.
Yeah, you know, just sort of a background. Were there any attempts, or did any other communities contact you or reach out to you from, you know, smaller cities, villages, towns, you know, and ask you, like, how could they work with you to, you know, sort of put together a group of, you know, municipalities that wanted local control? Was any of that going on?
Somewhat, yes. And mostly because of my role on the board of the League of Municipalities. The League of Municipalities lobbies for all the cities in Wisconsin. And so there was this talk. You know, I was just at their last state convention in La Crosse late last year with my colleague, Alderman Scott Spiker. And we were in discussions with other local leaders about how we could bring this home. There was talk. We knew that something could be coming. Some folks were not optimistic. They thought it wasn't going to happen. We're not going to see this increase in shared revenue for the entire state. And yet I was always optimistic that this could potentially happen, knowing that we had this change of leadership coming at the city and county in Milwaukee, with both David Crowley, our county executive, and Cavalier Johnson, our mayor. I knew that there could be a possibility that we could see movement, and Milwaukee could be a part of it. And those other municipalities were right there with us, wanting it for themselves and hoping that we could also get it for Milwaukee too, knowing how difficult it can be for Milwaukee to get what it can from a Republican legislature.
So the you mentioned this, the League of, what did you say it was?
The League of Municipalities.
So just for my listeners, what is the League of Municipalities, and what is its purpose?
Yes, the League is a nonprofit organization devoted to serving local governments across the great state of Wisconsin, in particular municipalities, so cities. So they have been there at the table on this. And in fact, we just had our big lobby day. It was the day that the Senate committee took up the state shared revenue bill. And I was there, and they let me open up the meeting with hundreds of local elected officials. They let this Southside Mexican girl from Milwaukee address this room full of hundreds of local officials and talk to them about why shared revenue is important to Milwaukee, and not just that increase in shared revenue, but the need to have a clean bill. And they let me speak to that, and they made it part of their lobbying packet, and I will forever be grateful, because they didn't have to do that, Mark. But that was the league, that was the other municipalities knowing we're all in this together.
So you use the term clean bill. I'm going to tell you, my perception is that there are a lot of people on the street that don't know what a clean bill means. So, and a clean bill, when I'm listening, it sounds like a term that politicians and folks elected use and has some meaning. So to the listeners, to the public, what does it mean to have a clean bill? And did, in fact, the League of Municipalities support a clean bill?
So to have a clean bill, for the listeners understand, that's a great question. That means we just wanted a bill that dealt with that fiscal aspect. you know, the increase in shared revenue. Let us leave it there. And let's not add policy that could be deemed a poison pill, that could be, that could be what some of our local governments don't want. In particular, they added pieces of policy in the state shared revenue bill that me and my colleagues are absolutely offended by. Things like wanting to get rid of our commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion. Things like gutting our fire and police commission. These things are unacceptable to me and my colleagues. And to the mayor of the city. We abhor these components of the bill. These are the pieces of policy that make the bill unclean. And so it is not a clean bill. And although we lobbied and lobbied for a clean bill, again, we're dealing with a Republican legislature in both the Assembly as well as the State Senate. And so we end up with a bill that is the opposite of clean. It is an unclean bill, and it includes not just that increase in shared revenue that we so desperately need, but also these other components of these other pieces of policy that we are absolutely opposed to.
So, folks, I am privileged to have Alderwoman JoCasta Zamarripa here, former state representative with a lot of experience, talking about the budget and shared revenue. And I want you to come back on the other side of the break. We're coming up to that soon, but because we're going to talk more about what is this poison pill and what are these policy provisions and where we're at. But before we go to the break, JoCasta, what kind of response did you get from the League of Municipalities and, you know, the other municipal entities around the state? Nice, short, 30-second answer.
Honestly, I believe that we got a warm response from the League of Municipalities. I know there was some concern initially around how they were registering in support. But in working with us and adding to their lobbying packet, and I know we only have a few seconds, I ended up very happy with their partnership with the city of Milwaukee, and I know that they continue to work with us to push to bring home our fair share of shared revenue.
Thank you. You know, I wanted to hear that out because this budget, this round doesn't mean it's the end of the state. It's not the end of the world. We're going to have new maps coming up. There is going to be a new world. But folks, come on back. Join me, Mark Thomsen, Attorney Mark Thomsen, on your Paul Revere show. We're going to be talking to Alderwoman JoCasta Zamarripa about the poison pills in the budget. Be right back. Welcome back, folks. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is your Paul Revere show. We are here every Monday night on WAUK 540 AM 101 FM. I'm delighted and honored to have Alderwoman JoCasta Zamarripa with us tonight. We're talking about the budget shared revenue discussion and the poison pill policy provisions that were buried in there by what I call the far right wing of the Republican Party. I remember being much younger in this state, and Governor Tommy Thomsen, I would have never seen this kind of these kinds of provisions being put in here. JoCasta, you had mentioned some of them. How do we get policy in a budget about dollars and cents, and how we're going to share, almost $7 billion of taxpayer money around the state? How is it that we get into a position where they're talking about attacking diversity, equity, and how they're talking about abolishing the fire and police commission in Milwaukee and its policymaking authority that's been around for, so many years, I don't even remember. How do we get there? And how do you see that?
How did we get here?
Yeah, and how did we get here? And what does all this mean? I mean, for the listener, that we hear budget talks, we hear there's $7 billion, and all of a sudden we're talking about other things.
Well, first, let me just say for the listeners, just for their edification, it's not unprecedented to put pieces of policy in something fiscally related in some budgetary matter. In fact, the Republicans are contradicting themselves. They consistently tell Tony, fiscal issues only, no policy in the budget. And yet, you know, Tony will put other great things in his budget, like every budget he's introduced since he became governor. He's also inserted driver's licenses for undocumented Wisconsinites into every single one of his biennial budgets. God bless him. God bless Tony Evers, the very first Wisconsin governor to ever have that type of valor. But he has done that. And the Republicans constantly, oh, strip out all that policy. It should only be fiscally related. And yet here we have, you know, we are demanding a clean bill without, you know, any policy. And they have inserted pieces of policy. Why do they do that? Because the Republicans are historically anti-Milwaukee, and they want to give it to us on the chin every single time. They'll be damned if they're going to give us our fair share of shared revenue finally, give us potentially the ability to implement a sales tax without making sure that we pay. And so they have inserted these hurtful things that, frankly, we know are part of a national strategy that conservative politicians are doing across this country. Like the DEI nonsense, the diversity, equity, and inclusion, terrible policy in the bill to try to limit our ability from being able to institute these good measures around diversity, equity, and inclusion. This is part of a national strategy that Republicans are trying to employ. And so that's why we find ourselves here with this crappy policy being inserted into this bill around, that should be specifically around increasing our shared revenue.
Have you heard why the far right Republicans are trying to attack the Fire and Police Commission and its policymaking ability in the city?
I can only assume. No, I haven't heard anything specific from any conservatives. But
I mean, why do you think it's there then?
Because they want to try to take away. It's a very, they set policy for our fire and police, and they want to take away that ability from our FPC to be able to institute good policies.
So there's been a lot of discussion and talks going back and forth. And I reported that there are, it sounds like, an agreement with the Republican leadership and our governor. I know you haven't seen the fine print yet, but what have you heard in terms of what that's going to look like for Milwaukee? And, you know, what's your perception at this point in time, knowing we don't have a done deal yet, but, it's coming down. What's your perception?
Yes. So what I know so far is basically what I think we all know, which is the governor and the Republican legislature, you know, the Assembly and the Senate seem to have come to a deal wherein supposedly, and again, we haven't seen this written yet. I don't have an amendment in my hands, but that says that they will pass the shared revenue bill. Unfortunately, it looks like all these crappy pieces of policy remain in the bill, but there'll also be some additions such as enabling legislation for the city of Milwaukee and Milwaukee County, which means it won't, the option to increase the sales tax will be voted on by our legislative bodies as opposed to having to go to a referendum.
I know that the city is waiting to see the fine print to look at it. I did note that there are some older persons have issued a press release disagreeing with some of that. We have a minute left here, JoCasta. So, you know, how do you just briefly see where it's sitting in the city right now?
I think that we all have some tough votes ahead of us, both the Wisconsin state legislature. I think of my Democratic colleagues in the state legislature and the difficulty that they're having right now with this terrible bill, but the need to increase shared revenue across the state. I feel for them. And I feel for my colleagues, those folks that put out that statement that you referenced this past Friday night. I feel their pain. I am against that shitty policy as well. But at the end of the day, we need to make sure that we're bringing home Milwaukee's fair share of shared revenue. We need to make sure that we can continue the city services that our residents.
Thank you, JoCasta. Folks, we'll be right back on the other side of the break. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. Hello, folks. Welcome back. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is your Paul Revere show. We are here, WAUK 540 AM 101 FM, every Monday night at 7. I have been talking the last couple of shows about the budget. We're sitting on almost $7 billion of surplus. We're talking about shared revenue and the municipalities who've been starved for years. It seems like there may be some relief, but at what price? And I'm honored tonight to have Representative Ryan Clancy, the rep from the Assembly 19th District. And uniquely, he also serves as the 4th District Supervisor for Milwaukee County. So Ryan brings a unique voice and insight to this discussion because he not only represents a statewide vantage point, but he also represents a county vantage point. And Milwaukee County and the city that is the target of what JoCasta Zamarripa talked about is the poison pill policy buried in this. So welcome, Ryan Clancy. Thanks for joining.
Thank you so much for having me. Appreciate being here.
So before we jump into your thoughts and observations of this whole process, this is the first time I've had a chance to have you on the show, so thank you so much. But why don't you just tell my listeners and a little bit about who you are and how you got into politics. And I know you're a family person. And I can see you're driving in the car, and the rumor is that you're coming back from Green Bay and the Democratic Party convention. So tell us a little bit about family man Ryan and the politician.
Thanks, yeah. And I still bristle at the term politician. I'll definitely forgive you for that. I was an activist. I was an organizer. I was a teacher kind of prior to entering politics. So I still like to consider myself at least an activist, an organizer who happens to have been elected. Five amazing kids. I've got my wife Becky, keeps everything, sane in our household and is a successful entrepreneur, small business owner. I've been on the county board now for a little over 3 years. I'm looking forward to only having one job soon because for the next year I am both a representative and a county supervisor. But yeah, as you noted, it's given me a really interesting perspective. I would say that I have two tough votes coming up at the state and at the county, but neither of them is going to be tough. I think this shared revenue package is terrible. It seems to have gotten worse rather than better recently. And I'm proud to vote both against shared revenue at the state and then likely against sales tax at the county. It is a terrible and regressive tax, and the idea that we would look to that rather than getting more of our own shared revenue back from the state is really frustrating. And I think that we could have done so much good. And I think without, all the barbs, the poison pill, all those terrible policy provisions that are part of this package, we could be having a serious conversation about, giving every community across Wisconsin more of their own revenue back. We seem intent to do just the opposite, and it's incredibly frustrating.
So let's just take a step back.
Sure.
Just sort of globally for the listeners, how did you perceive the discussion on shared revenue, and how should have it occurred? And how did you share opinions with other members of municipalities around the state? since you're on the county board as, you know, county rep here.
Yeah, yeah. And I should point out that I authored legislation a few months ago. I mean, everybody saw something coming. Maybe it was a failure of imagination on my part, but I didn't realize how terrible this would be. Ideally, I mean, you know, executives from all levels would have, you know, sat down with the Republicans. They would have seen that there was so much terrible punitive policy in this, and they would have gotten right back up from the table and said, no, we are not going to negotiate when there is the destruction of DEI on the table. We're not going to negotiate when there is the idea that we'd have to have ever increasing police budgets. These are not serious proposals. These are not designed to do anything but sort of punish Milwaukee. And it really strikes me as just a terrible laundry list of already failed policies or things that the Republicans couldn't push through. But it's infuriating to know that folks sat at that table and said, yeah, let's leave DEI on the table. Let's, you know, the total destruction of DEI. And let's talk about other things. Let's talk about giving more money to private schools. And it's hard not to feel betrayed by that. And I've spoken to a lot of folks that share that same opinion. With a 14-2 vote on the county board, just in our last session, we passed a piece of legislation saying very clearly that the county board is on record as being in favor of more shared revenue. And I think, you know, most people are. That we're in favor of the autonomy for local municipalities and county to spend those dollars as they see fit, rather than being dictated to by the state. So I was, it's tough to get, that sort of majority to agree on anything at the county, but it was good to see us speak in a nearly unified voice. And I hope that reflects, you know, future actions as well.
Let me ask this, do you sense that around the state that there was a fear from local communities that they'd been starved so long that a chance for some money was like, we have to go for it? Is it, you know, like small towns around the state, you know, with terrible Wi-Fi, liberal Wi-Fi, and all their kids are, you know, leaving and going to cities, and you got farmers and people that are desperate, right?
I have a ton of sympathy and empathy there, and I get that. And it's really unfortunate that Robin Voss and others have tried to pit those villages and towns against the larger cities when really we're all in this together, right? When you hear me, when you hear a lot of folks talking about shared revenue, we're not saying that just Milwaukee needs more of our own money. I'm saying that every community needs more shared revenue dollars, because you're right. Every community in the state has been starved of its own shared revenue for many, many years. What's frustrating to me is that Milwaukee is the economic engine of the state, and we are essentially subsidizing a lot of these communities around the state. And that's okay to some extent, right? Like, we have more economic activity here. I get it. But the idea that Milwaukee and Milwaukee County and Dane County would only get a 10% increase to our shared revenue, when some of the smaller municipalities are getting 5,000% increases, is just inherently unfair. Like, I'm happy to share some of the wealth that Milwaukee provides. I'm not happy to give up our local control and to see our own ability to make policy crushed in order to take so many, you know, so few scraps from the table and give everybody else more. So I would hope that municipalities and counties would be in this together. And kind of standing up against these policy provisions, some of which do apply not just to Milwaukee, but across the state. The ever-increasing police budgets and numbers of police, that applies to everything across the state. And that's going to do some real economic damage.
So have you heard from smaller communities on how they're responding to this proposal that says you're going to have to spend dollars on more police, whether you need them or not, and you're not going to have the option to put those dollars into mental health or something, you know, something that you really need in your own village?
Yeah, and it, you know, some people are really frustrated. I think people that understand the larger context here, that this is an attack on local control, are frustrated by it. And I think they're more likely to kind of stand in unison with other municipalities and counties that would be hit by that. And there are other ones, as you noted, that have been started for so long they're looking at a, you know, double or triple or quadruple digit increase in percentage of their shared revenue, and they're just going to grab it. And it's as frustrating as that is, I understand it. And, you know, Voss and the Republicans at the state are really masterful at sort of, you know, pitting entities against each other. And as frustrating as that is, I can understand that an entity that is starving just wants to get more shared revenue, because it's shared revenue at the local level that people really see and really makes a big deal in their lives. It, at the county level, you know, it means mental health. It means parks. It means transit. It means all the things that make our community, you know, great, safe places to live. And it's hard to turn that down. And I get it. But I would hope that they would show some solidarity for the larger cities that are really being screwed by this.
You know, before we get into sort of where we're going to be going here in the next few weeks, how do you sit there and you perceive this both as a local rep and as a state rep? How do you perceive these poison pills? What are the provisions, and particularly those that are aimed at Milwaukee County? What are those provisions, and, you know, how would you describe them to listeners?
Sure. And I think, you know, they're all bad, and we could sit here for several hours and go over the, you know, the 18 or so provisions that are, you know, kind of one worse than the last.
Well, let's focus on, say, the top five worst. What are they? How do you see them?
Yeah, certainly one of the most onerous ones is that ever-increasing police presence. And I think it's frustrating to see that take hold. And that is kind of a global one. That's not confined just to Milwaukee County. One of the most onerous ones, or several are really, these are already policy fights that, you know, that local grassroots organizations like the Milwaukee Alliance Against Racist and Political Repression and Leaders Igniting Transformation, and these are by and large, like BIPOC-led organizations, in some cases, youth-led organizations, that fought for you know, policy victories on the FPC, so Milwaukee's Fire and Police Commission. This legislation would not only, you know, add a basically police union member to that body, but it would strip away the very ability of the Fire and Police Commission to set policy at all. That's why it exists. It would become an advisory body. This seems to be a direct response to Mapper's victory on body cam footage. So just a few weeks ago, they won at the FPC the ability to see body cam footage delivered to families of victims of police violence or critical incidents within 48 hours, and then a release to the public in 15 days. And that's monumental. And I've spoken to families that have been waiting years, sometimes in one case up to 9 years, for footage of their family members' last moments. And, you know, the FPC losing the ability to set that policy really sets us back. The other big one fought for by Leaders Igniting Transformation was severing the Milwaukee Police Department contracts with MPS. This poison pill would put 25 sworn officers, so cops, into MPS schools, and they'd have to be assigned there. And the list just goes on and on. There are attacks on light rail, so the HOP. There are attacks on DEI. There's attacks on how much we can spend on arts and culture. It was as if the Republicans passed around a hat and said, just write down the top three things that you hate about Milwaukee's residents, and we're going to do something to attack them specifically. And it is just beyond frustrating that those are all in the final version. Through all these negotiations, it looks as though there was no progress made. And in fact, it looks worse than it did even a few weeks ago.
You know, when you say it looks worse, tell me what you mean by that.
Sure. So in between the last draft, when it left the assembly, and the most recent one, by all accounts, and again, we don't have the exact text in front of us, but by all accounts, one of the changes went from a referendum on sales tax, popular referendum of the people, to going to having to get a 2/3 vote in both the Milwaukee's Common Council and the county board. And the other significant change was a weird package of education funding, which some folks are claiming is a victory.
I have not spoken to a single education advocate who is not incensed about the details here. It's a tiny increase to education funding. I think most people would have wanted and expected more from the regular budget process. In exchange for that, there's a huge amount of money going toward private schools.
Hold on 1 second.
You bet.
Ryan Clancy, we'll be right back on the break. We're going to continue this discussion of the poison pills and the budget shared revenue and how it got worse. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is the Paul Revere Show. We'll be right back. Say I grew up stained. They ain't a laugh, it ain't nothing, cause I'm gonna burn me something. Now you go think I'm stained. I put it on my mama. I said I stay up with something. Now I was stay with me. I just wanna rock. Body of the yacht. Welcome back, folks. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is your Paul Revere Show. We are here every Monday night at 7 to 8. WAUK 540 AM 101 FM. Our focus is on democracy in the state of Wisconsin and how do we always move forward. I am honored and privileged to have Representative Ryan Clancy of the 19th Assembly District, but he's also has a unique perspective because he currently serves also as the 4th District Supervisor in the County of Milwaukee. And so he's giving us both a municipal, local, and state view of this budget where we've got $7 billion that should be going to the people. And instead, it's not. It's been created a divide and conquer and an attack on communities that they've starved for years. It's really quite phenomenal. But Ryan, you were talking about the sort of this weird package of educational funding that's in the current bill. How is that playing out and how do you think that's going to play? Tell us about it.
Yeah. And it was strange. So it was absolutely terrible. It was all this terrible policy in there when it left the assembly. We thought that it might get a little bit better in the Senate, that the folks at the table would negotiate out some of those terrible policy pieces. They didn't. And then there's also this really weird education package. So the number of new dollars coming towards education in this is small. It is not this huge victory that we're hearing some people trumpet about. I would have expected educational advocates would have expected much more from it. And in fact, to get back to keep up with inflation, we'd need about, I think, $1,500 per pupil more than what we've been getting. I think this puts us in a $300 to $400 range more. So this is not a big win. But one of the most disturbing parts of this package, as a public educator, former public educator myself, is that there's a huge handout in there to private and non-instrumentality charter schools. That feels like a betrayal. So not only did the larger package didn't get better, it got worse. And this seems now like not only an attack on, you know, local autonomy, local control, the ability of Milwaukee and Milwaukee County to govern, but it's an attack on public education. So I'm holding out some hope that the specifics in this education package, which aren't written down yet, it doesn't even have that Foxconn level of like it's written on a napkin somewhere. There is no text yet. There's just an agreement in theory. I'm hoping that those are terrible enough, frankly, that the governor vetoes it and the governor will have that opportunity considerably after it passes or not both houses on Wednesday.
So, you know, when as a state rep do you expect to see the language? I heard something that Joint Finance is going to be looking at it tomorrow, Tuesday. So how is it that we get this major, massive piece of legislation written and to our reps in time before they vote? Is there any chance that you're going to see it?
Yeah, not long. I mean, the last big piece of legislation that we had literally hours before we were, about an hour and a half, 2 hours before we were supposed to vote on it. And it was this, and there were 90 amendments to it. We had to process and interpret and figure out 90 different changes to this, none of which made it conceivably, you know, better. It all got worse again. I expect the same thing this time. So there's actually a couple different pieces of this. There's going to be the larger shared revenue package, probably. And we probably expect to see separate pieces for the education piece. There's also another piece in that education part that is literacy funding, which sounds really good on the front side, right? I was a former an English teacher for a while. Literacy is really important. But what the Republicans have been talking about doing recently is the sort of literacy they do in some other southern states, where they hold students back for many years at a time until they hit these literacy goals. And those students' academic careers suffer as a result. You see, you know, much higher dropout rates, you know, because the students are markedly older than their peers. They have done okay on their test scores for that 1 year, often because you have, you know, kids that are a few years older than they should be taking them. But it's at a tremendous social cost and a significant fiscal cost to the schools. If that's the sort of literacy that we're talking about here, and that was agreed to in theory just a few days ago, I'm very much opposed to that. Very much in favor of literacy. I'm very much opposed to, you know, retaining kids multiple years in order to, you know, bolster their scores on one specific test of that.
So as you sit there, and I'm going to put this out there, you were up at the Democratic Party convention. What discussion was going on, you know, in the back rooms or on the floor about budget, shared revenue, almost $7 billion in surplus, and the future of the party? And I mean, some of the key players were there, and I mean, you were there. So, what are you hearing, and what are the odds going forward?
When I go to that convention, I always talk policy. People come up to me like, "Hi, how are you?" And I'm like, "Let's talk about this thing that's on my mind right now." But everybody during convention wanted to talk shared revenue, and a lot of people were as frustrated as I was nearly with this, and realizing that it is terrible for Milwaukee County and also other municipalities. And I was really impressed with the, you know, the speeches of a lot of folks. Gwen Moore had, you know, many of these poison pill things on craft sticks, right? And she stood up there during her speech and showed us, I think, really powerfully that individually all these things, you know, fall apart. But if we stand together, they can't all be broken together. It was a powerful image. I really appreciated her standing in solidarity with Milwaukee and Milwaukee County and the rest of the state in that way. And I hope that we can stand strong against this, because we have to do better. Passing this legislation would clearly do a lot of long-term damage. And, you know, we can talk about if some of those things can be undone by court, you know, challenges. We can talk about spending the next half decade or decade trying to undo the damage from this shared revenue bill. But the fact is that those things shouldn't have been in there in the first place, and we shouldn't have been sitting down at the table while they were. And I think many people are coming to that realization now. And it's not too late. The governor does not need to sign this.
So, you know, I think it's this notion that we can't afford to spend the next 5-10 years or longer trying to get back to where we're at. I mean, it really hits me on the Fire and Police Commission. The institution's been around forever, designed to, you know, take the politics and the, you know, cronyism out of the chief of police. And we've got it. So, here, you got 20 seconds to wrap this thing up, Ryan. Tell us the listeners and the public, what should we be doing, and what are we hopeful or what?
If you're listening and you believe in local control, if you believe in the battles that we've fought in Milwaukee and already won, what I need you to do is reach out both to your electeds and to the governor and ask them not to vote for this and not to sign it.
That is Representative Ryan Clancy. Thank you so much, Ryan, for joining us. This is Attorney Mark Thomsen. This is your Paul Revere Show, folks. You heard it here. We have much at stake. Our whole future, we can only go one way, folks, forward. See you next week. Thanks again, Ryan.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate you.
Take care.